Hello and welcome to the CBSE curriculum on artificial intelligence for class 8th and 9th developed with support from Intel. This audio visual will help you better understand and follow the facilitator handbook.
To take India forward in the journey of artificial intelligence, we recently decided that we must inculcate it as a curriculum, and we introduced it as a subject in our schools in the country. I'm very glad to share that 883 schools in the country have actually lapped up the idea and ensured that their children take up this as a part of their curriculum. We have begun teaching artificial intelligence as a subject in these 883 schools from grade 8 onwards. As a part of this process, in these 883 schools, 71,000 children are, as of today, learning the ropes of artificial intelligence. To help them learn this, we have actually taken teacher training to the next level and aggressively been following it. 11 CBSE workshops for teacher training have been held in the country, in which almost 343 schools have been covered so far, and 483 teachers are AI trained and AI ready. I'm also very glad to share that we plan to take this forward in a very, very big way in the coming years. A very big thank you to Intel for supporting us in this journey.
So what exactly is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence, or AI, is a form of intelligence, a type of technology, and a field of study. AI theory and development of computer systems, both machines and software, are able to perform tasks that normally require human intelligence. Artificial intelligence covers a broad range of domains and applications and is expected to impact every field in the future. Overall, its core idea is building machines and algorithms which are capable of performing computational tasks that would otherwise require human-like brain functions. Schools have an important and responsible role to provide learning opportunities for the students and guide them on the path to success. Artificial intelligence is gaining the spotlight across applications in our personal and professional lives. We need to take charge of preparing ourselves and our students for the future. Hence, Central Board of Secondary Education, CBSE, has decided to introduce artificial intelligence as an elective subject. Learning to facilitate is learning to know the difference between when to guide or suggest and when to allow students to figure out and understand for themselves, question, hypothesize, and take the challenge. Being a facilitator is mostly about how to motivate, encourage, and simplify. Learning to use appropriate vocabulary while giving feedback is the skill set most required by a facilitator. Give feedback in a positive manner to inspire students to explore and persevere in their learning. Ensure that continuity is maintained in mentorship and monitoring to facilitate students' learning. Online feedback, interactive discussions on problems and challenges are some of the ways to assist this. We want to get to know you better. Home is where your heart is. Your home will always be the place for which you feel the deepest affection, no matter where you are. Draw a floor plan of your dream home. Does it have a swimming pool, or does it have a place for you to indulge in your favorite hobby? Or if you like gardening, do you have a garden indoors or outdoors? Imagine you can look down from above at all the spaces in your dream home. What does it look like? Draw it.
Imagine what you can have. Imagine that you have won a lottery worth rupees 10 crore. So what can you make out of it? Think about it and draw a layout.
The purpose of this section is to expose students to the three domains of AI: natural language processing, computer vision, and data for AI.
What is the scenario? There are three challenges which that scientist has curated for us. We need to go to each of the challenges one by one, solve it, and get the next challenge clue. And as soon as we are done with all the three challenges, we have saved the world. But there is a time limit to it. We just have 60 minutes to solve all the three challenges. So teachers, are you ready?
Students will go through three AI games in the form of a challenge. The link for each challenge will be printed on small slips and given to the students one after the other. They have to finish all the three challenges within an hour. Let's quiz the learners on the game they just played. You can either go for a pen or paper quiz, or you can visit any open-sourced, free online portal, one of which is Kahoot, and create your quiz there.
The very first session for us is a quiz. Kahoot is a quiz platform in which we can engage the kids in a very fun way. How many of you got it right? Okay, great. So we have 12 wrong answers, and I think two teams did not even attempt. Let's see the results. BBPS Harish on top with 8 on 10. Then we have Vini, 6 on 10.
Imagine the world in 2030 and write a letter to your future self. Be sure to mention things that you think your future self would probably be doing and experiencing in daily life.
So now to reflect in this module, we would like to write a letter to our future self. This is a template which is already there in the book. You can open the book and you can even see it. So you are writing a letter to your future self. Think futuristic. What sort of could change in the coming 10 years? So now I would request any three of you to share your letters with us.
So Jenny, have things changed a lot? Do we still have a lot of traffic jams and pollution? Has AI proved to be a bone and solved the issue of depleting natural resources? You must be so used to having everything done automatically, programmed just the way you want, while we struggle to cope with the transition from hands-on to hands-free. Is our pet dog doing well, or have you replaced it with a pet robot? It is so much easier. How is your new job? Must be really nice to be a teleporter who documents all the time travel through hologram storytelling.
You must be so used to all the old and very much used technologies like computer vision, neural networks, face recognition, robotics, etc. While we struggle to get an understanding of basic necessities of these tools and technologies to be used in near future for sure. Is our pet healthy and doing well? Uh-huh. Or have you replaced it with our digitally AI-enabled creation?
Nice.
To be used for our own benefit. So, must be really nice to be a master and skilled AI programmer.
Writing from Noida on 11th June 2019. Dear Nazia, it feels a little strange to be writing to my future self, but it's also rather exciting. At present, I am very interested in making TikTok videos and the virtual reality interface, and I am sure this is a hobby that has proved beneficial, and I feel that I am now a skilled actor. So tell me, have things changed a lot? Do we still have a lot of corruption? Has AI proved to be beneficial with the implementation of the tracking chips being inserted in the currency bills? You must be so used to the luxury of not moving around much, and yet getting everything done at your commands while we struggle to complete our household chores in the absence of our mate. Is your pet, Mitu the parrot, doing well, or have you replaced it with Alexa 3.0, the flying chirping robot that takes your orders and delivers hard copies around? Haha, it's so much easier. How is your preparation for the new job? Must be really nice to be a bot analyst. Have you changed the house yet? I'm sure things have turned out well for you in 2030. Great to know that you don't have to sweat much due to the wearable air conditioner gadget. I wish I had one now in this peak summer. It's been nice writing to you as 10 years younger. Hope this letter brings back old memories. Yours faithfully, Nazia, who's 10 years younger than you.
Do you like listening to stories? How about being a creative writer? Using your floor plan as a base for your story, use the Story Speaker extension in Google Docs and write a story. Ensure that you give or write specific instructions in your story that enables the Story Speaker to respond back with an answer.
You have invested 15 minutes of your life into designing your dream home. Let us experience it. How would we experience it? Using Story Speaker. Now, Story Speaker is a tool. How many of you know about it already? No one? Yes. Story Speaker is an extension to Google Docs. All of you use Google Docs?
Yes.
So, Google Docs has several add-ons to it. One of them is Story Speaker. Story Speaker is a tool which lets you write an interactive story in which whatever you write can be interactive. Like if I'm writing that, hi, you are at Ambika's place, would you like to enter? As soon as you say yes, the story moves ahead. Now your story needs to be interactive. How would it be interactive? While the Story Speaker asks question, the user needs to answer. So if I'm asking, do I go straight or backwards? So then the user might say either straight or backwards. These are the two options which I expect the person to say. And according to these two options, my story would diverge. So let's quickly set up the Story Speaker. You can just go online on Google, search for Story Speaker, download it and install it.
Are you a good storyteller? The Story Speaker extension can be accessed with docs.google.com. After signing in on Google and opening Google Docs, go to Add-ons and choose Story Speaker. Click on Basic Template and work on the same after understanding how it works. This world is the home for life of people, plants and animals. The materials and resources that the planet provides help us to sustain life. In order to build a better world for everyone, it is important that we take care to conserve, preserve, and protect our shelter and the life of those in this world. The member states of the United Nations have agreed to achieve 17 Sustainable Development Goals or SDGs by 2030. Let's try and understand social issues through a board game about the Sustainable Development Goals or SDGs called Go Goals. We will learn more about Sustainable Development Goals and how people are using AI to solve some of the world's problems. This is what your game board looks like. This game is very similar to Snakes and Ladders. Players advance the number of spaces by rolling a single dice. If a player lands at the bottom of a ladder, they can immediately climb to the top. If a player lands at the top of the slide, they immediately move to the bottom of the slide. If a player lands on SDG goal field 1 to 17, they draw a card corresponding to the goal number. Another player will read the card question. A correct answer from the card drawer will allow the player to roll the dice again. The first player to arrive on 2030 is the winner. Let's play.
Whenever we are talking about artificial intelligence to our kids, it's really important that they should know about these goals so that whenever they feel like applying their knowledge into their lives, they can use it to solve any of the goals. Because as you can see, a lot of problems which are around us are already covered in it. So, now to introduce SDGs to the kids,
we have come up again with a game. So there is this game named Go Goals. Now this is a board game, just like Snakes and Ladders. And it has been designed by the UN itself. It's open sourced and available online. You can go online and check Go Goals game. This game has been made to introduce SDGs to the kids in a very fun way, just like Snakes and Ladders. So whenever you play Snakes and Ladders, you need tokens and you need a dice. Now in this board game, as you can see, you would start from here. Now when you start from here, you can see 17 SDGs are mapped on the board and they are labeled as well. So there is a 1, 2, 3 and so on.
We will now explore the emergence of artificial intelligence, AI, jobs in various fields such as healthcare, security, education, agriculture, entertainment, service, and transport.
We know there are a lot of purposes that could be solved with AI, but when we talk about the possibilities, what are the possible technologies which might emerge through AI? So let's talk about the fields in which you think AI can be incorporated. Medical, healthcare, travel and tourism, then
security,
education, okay,
peace, justice,
space, definitely, automobiles, entertainment, manufacturing and whatnot. AI has possibilities in almost all the domains around us. So that is why in this session we are going to explore these possibilities. We are actually going to share some research templates with you. So it has been all gaming and all activities. Now let's start researching. So what you need to do is, each table would be getting a theme. And you need to go online and search on that theme as to how AI could be incorporated in that theme. Now, as I share the research template with you, we are going to fill up the companies. You're going to research online on the themes which we give to you. Then you're going to fill up about the skill sets. Now, skill sets, there would be soft skills and technical skills. How these skills could be evolved 10 years down the line? Would they change? Would they not? It's up to you. You need to think, you need to find out, and you need to fill it in the research template. And in the end, do you think, are there any sort of ethical concerns which lie in your domain? Like if I talk about incorporating AI in healthcare, are there some ethics issue? Think on it, research on it, and fill it in the template.
Now, let's use our findings to make a job advertisements of the future.
Now imagine that this job vacancy is available in year 2030, 10 years later. Now, 10 years later, you have your own company, XYZ, any company you can name it. So your company has a job which is related to AI in your specific domain.
Agriculture specialist for soil healthcare prediction, weather prediction, soil moisture and temperature prediction, and accurate prediction to the farmers for integrated computer vision and machine learning technology.
Data scientist technical requirements are high: Hadoop, Pip, Spark, Python Advanced, Scala, and minimum experience of 7 years is required.
We are hiring AI experts, and the company name is Intel at Moon Edu. So we are hiring AI experts who can develop feature systems.
Let's debate about the boon and bane of various AI applications in the different industries we researched about in the last activity. The important thing to remember is the consequences of your actions while applying AI.
Now let's get ourselves think about the ethical issues which we can have around AI. Now all of you have your domains with you. Right? Everybody remembers their domains? Now we are going to have a debate over here. What is going to happen? Each team will be given 3 minutes to speak. The first person from the affirmative team would stand up and speak for a minute. As soon as that person stops, the person from the against team would stand up and speak for 1 minute. Again, the chance would come to the affirmative team and the second speaker would speak, then second speaker of against team, then third speaker would conclude the argument from the for team, and the against team's third person would be concluding their argument. So 3 people would be participating in the debate from each team.
Suppose a website is introduced for the first time, then AI cybersecurity can easily find the bugs in that.
When we provide the security, there's a chance of AI terrorism that comes up. Okay, now what type of terrorism will be there? There will be a probability that that will affect the health, that will affect our transportation system. Because with the help of AI, we are still not having that that level of security.
Machine has so many things, so many challenges, so many features, so many qualities. Like it enhances electric health record. Okay, better integration. And many points are there. One more point I'm just adding. Reducing unnecessary hospital visit by alerting the staff when patient care is needed. It is very important.
AI will play an important role in education, as AI can do away with teachers' repetitive tasks like checking their notebook, making report cards and all, and it will bring efficiency and effectiveness as in other sectors.
Using AI doesn't mean that it will lead to absence of teachers. There is no challenge to the teaching jobs because the human factor is there. Also, it can engage the students in practical experiences so that they can easily comprehend all their targets. Also, it can be a customized education. It becomes hard for a teacher to meet the expectation of all the students. So it can be customized individually easily with the help of AI.
We will now learn about the AI project cycle and get familiar with it. The stages of the AI project cycle are problem scoping, data acquisition, data exploration, modeling, evaluation.
You're introducing AI project cycle to them. Now, while we're talking about introducing AI project cycle, it means that now I am aware of how AI is relating to my lives, how purposeful can AI be, what are the possibilities around AI, and what are the ethical concerns which I need to address around artificial intelligence. But now, if I want to make something out of AI, make something out of the knowledge which I am gaining from this curriculum, how do I get started? Have you heard of design thinking? Okay, so a very similar concept to it is the AI project cycle. Now, whenever we are talking about solving a problem through AI, having a purpose around AI, we need to have a framework in which we can put all our thoughts. So that's why we come up with a project cycle, which is an AI project cycle. We start off with problem scoping and we see that, okay, this is a problem. What could be the possible reasons to this problem? Why is this problem happening? Who are the people who are getting affected with it? And what would happen if I solve the problem? So these are some of the things which I look at when I am at the problem scoping stage. When I come to data acquisition, I think of collecting the images, the photographs of all the people who are authorized to enter the world. Only the authorized people. And I take their images as much as I can, as many angles as I can get. Once I get my data, now I go to
data exploration, which is the third stage. Now, whenever you have data, you need to explore it. When you have image data, how will you explore it? You will see if the images are appropriate or not, if they are of same size or not, same aspect ratio, proper lighting. These are all the parameters which you focus on. But imagine, if you are working on an economical problem and you have an Excel sheet full of data, maybe with 25,000 lines, would you be able to make any sense out of that table? No. So most of the times when we need to make sense out of a table, we plot it. We plot graphs out of it, because visual data always makes most sense to humans. So we visualize the data. Now, as soon as I get my data, as soon as I get my images, I go and explore them and check if the images are appropriate or not. After that, I come to modeling. Now, modeling is the stage where you have got your data, you have cleaned it up, and you are now going to implement your AI model onto the data. How do you do that? There are already so many AI models available online. You just go online, get some of the models which you have, tweak them a bit, and make them of your use. So now I have made my surveillance system which can actually detect if there is any unauthorized person going inside the wall, except for the people whom I have trained the machine for. The machine would directly inform any of the police authorities. Now, after making this model, I definitely need to test it. That is when we come to the evaluation stage. Now, at the evaluation stage, we check if the model is accurate or not. If the authorized person is going with his head down, is the machine able to detect? If an unauthorized person is going with a very familiar face, is the machine going to detect? So these are some of the evaluation points on which I test my machine if it is working fine or not. And I get the accuracy of the machine. Once I get the accuracy, I definitely understand, do I need to remodel it or can I deploy it? So this is how we go through the whole AI project cycle. And every step has its own importance in it. The very first step of AI project cycle is problem scoping. In problem scoping, we try to use two things. One is the 4 W's problem canvas, and the other thing is problem scoping template.
Problem scoping is done using the 4 W's framework. So what are the 4 W's? It refers to who, what, when, and why. After filling the 4 W's problem canvas, you now need to summarize all the cards into one template. The problem statement template helps us to summarize all the key points into one single template so that in future, whenever there is need to look back at the basis of the problem, we can take a look at the problem statement template and understand the key elements of it. As we move ahead in the AI project cycle, we come across the second element, which is data acquisition. Data can be a piece of information or facts and statistics collected together for reference or analysis. Whenever we want an AI project to be able to predict an output, we need to train it first using data. You need to acquire data which will become the base of your project, as it will help you in understanding what the parameters that are related to the problem are scoping. You go for data acquisition by collecting data from various reliable and authentic sources. Since the data you collect would be in large quantities, you can try to give it a visual image or different types of representations like graphs, databases, flowcharts, maps, etc. This makes it easier for you to interpret the patterns in which your acquired data follows.
We talked about system maps, what are the possible data features for every problem, and how can you build a relation between all the elements, and how can you see which elements are crucial. After this, if you want to acquire data, so there are some open government sources online. We just need to make sure that whenever we go online to acquire data, the websites or the portals which we are referring to, they need to be reliable and authentic. There must be some XYZ website which is offering me the rainfall data for 2015, but it might not be reliable, it might not be authentic. So it's always advisable if you want data like this, you always go to the open government websites on which you get such form of data. What could be other ways of acquiring data? Surveys, newspapers,
questionnaires,
then one-to-one interactions, definitely. So these could be the possible ways in which you can acquire more and more data.
We use system maps to understand complex issues with multiple factors that affect each other. In a system, every element is interconnected. In a system map, we try to represent that relationship through the use of arrows. Within a system map, we will identify loops. These loops are important because they represent a specific chain of cause and effects. A system typically has several chains of causes and effects.
So now, we'll be going ahead with a game, okay? Now, I'll be giving you 8 elements. Now look at these elements and tell me, when they be linked to a water cycle? Let us all link them to a water cycle. Now, what you need to do is, you need to make a water cycle on the paper which has been given to you. Considering that these are the only elements which you need to put in your cycle. And also you need to mention all the possible loops in it. So you don't need to draw, you don't need to explain the process, precipitation, evaporation and all sort of things. You just need to put these elements and make a water cycle out of them.
We will now explore different types of graphs used in data visualization. We need to understand why we do data exploration before jumping straight into training an AI model. When we get a set of data in our hands, spending time to explore it will help get a sense of the trends, relationships and patterns present in the data. It will also help us better decide on which model or models to use in the subsequent AI project cycle stage. We use visualization as a method because it is much easier to comprehend information quickly and communicate the story to others.
So now that we have acquired data, we have talked about data features, we have mapped them into systems, what else? Suppose now we are working on the rainfall data for past 3 years. Would you be able to analyze that data? When you talk about AI, it works on thousands of data values. It's very difficult for us to analyze such data in a tabular form. So what do? We explore it, we visualize it with the help of graphs. So that is what the third stage is. To quickly get a sense of the trends, relationships and patterns, we can quickly understand that, okay, this value is going down here. Stock market, if we get numbers, we won't be able to understand. But through graphs, it's really easy for us to understand that which company is doing well. We are going to explore data. And how are you going to do that? With the help of an activity. I showed you 5 problems right now. One was, how to predict the best time for seeding and sowing of crops. Then there was how to improve the exam scores of students. Then the third was how to predict whether the song makes it to the billboard or not. Then the fourth one was how to preserve Taj Mahal efficiently. And then how to predict or prevent illegal poaching of elephant tusks. These were the 5 problems. Now I would again be giving one problem to one table. And you have to come up with some data. Now we have already discussed data features. select any two data features or any data features, any number of data features, and you need to make two graphs. The data could be assumed by you. Assume data and make two graphs. Now the graphs need not be bar graph, line graph, pie chart, no. We have given you this website. Datawizcatalog.com. Select two graphs and draw those two graphs on the sheets which we give you. In the end, when we complete this activity, your graphs should be able to show us some pattern or some trend which can lead towards solving the problem.
Select to filter past ahead. We have taken two factors. One is the number of problems. Taj Mahal. Factors affecting the Taj Mahal. So we have taken the data feature as number of industries in nearby Taj Mahal.
So here we have a bar chart. And the data which we have taken is the number of elephants present in different countries of Africa. So in the x-axis there is number of elephants and in the y-axis there is name of countries.
Introduction to Common Regression, Classification and clustering models. After exploring the patterns, you can decide upon the type of model you would build to achieve the goal. For this, you can research online and select various models which give a suitable output. You can test the selected models and figure out which is the most efficient one.
Now in modeling, we talk about the technical part of AI, where we are actually going to make some sort of an algorithm. We have been talking about artificial intelligence since day one. You must have also heard about machine learning or deep learning. Now, a lot of times machine learning and AI, these terms are used like as an alternative to each other. Although they are almost same, but there still lies a difference between them. So let us right now focus on as to how AI, ML and DL are quite different from each other. Starting with AI, as you can see this diagram, you can see AI is an umbrella term. It covers all machine learning as well as deep learning. Both of them are subsets to AI. Now what is AI? AI is any technique that enables computers to mimic human intelligence. Now any machine which is trying to mimic our intelligence, which is trying to think by its own, is known as artificially intelligent. It has a set of rules in it, but it works on the same rules, but it is giving you outputs according to what you need, according to the data. So AI is all based upon data. The basic difference between normal algorithms and AI is data. That you train the models, you train an artificially intelligent machine with the help of data. Now talking about the other term, which is machine learning, it's written that it's a subset of AI that enables machines to improve at tasks with experience. Now what does that mean? Once I've trained my machine with data, it is supposed to give me output. Now once it starts giving me output, it is possible that it might go wrong at some places. The answer might be wrong. Now the machine considers its wrong answers and takes them into consideration for the next time, so that if this exception comes again, the machine is ready to give the correct answer for that as well. So in machine learning, the machine is learning with its own experiences, with its own mistakes. Now, how would the machine know that it's a mistake which it has made? It is us which let the machine know that this answer is incorrect. And how do we do that? We compare it with the real data and we give the comparison analysis through the machine back. And the machine takes that analysis into consideration, and if that is an exception, it gets counted. So then we come to deep learning. Deep learning is a very small subset of AI. It has multiple machine learning algorithms which are running simultaneously and has a very complex kind of an algorithm. And that is why it requires more data. Now, like in previous years, we did not have much data. So that is why deep learning was a concept which was still undiscovered. But nowadays, since everybody is mining data, a lot of companies are working on deep learning. A very good example of deep learning could be neural networks, which has multiple machine learning algorithms working simultaneously. If you have a chatbot, if you want to design a chatbot, what happens is, in your story speaker, you know that it is an interactive story, and whatever inputs you give, it diverges, the story diverges. But that story is already written by you. It is not intelligent. It is not changing on the basis of your inputs. Now, if the machine starts changing, now in that story speaker also, you can have AI, because then you can have added features, like you can add names so the machine would remember your name, and the next time if you go back, it should remember your name. Some sort of intelligence, if we try to put in the story speaker itself, it will become AI. Now, how does a chatbot becomes a part of machine learning? What happens whenever you are training a chatbot, you would train it with some basic words, a basic dictionary, a basic language data. After that, whenever a user interacts with a chatbot, each and every word which is new for the chatbot retains it and it adds to its memory. So for the next time, when the same word is used in the same context, now everything has been noted in the machine. The word, its context, and its meaning. I have not told the machine what is the context or what is the meaning. The machine has figured it out by itself. And it has put it into a separate chunk. Now, the next time when the same word comes, the machine knows that, okay, I need to go to this chunk and get the desirable output. This is how machine learning works.
In general, there are two approaches taken by researchers when building AI models. They either take a rule-based approach or learning approach. A rule-based approach is generally based on the data and rules fed to the machine, where the machine reacts accordingly to deliver the desired output. Under learning approach, the machine is fed with data and the desired output, to which the machine designs its own algorithm or set of rules to match the data to the desired output fed into the machine. The most efficient model is now the base of your AI project, and you can develop your algorithm around it. Once the modeling is complete, you now need to test your model on some newly fetched data. The results will help you in evaluating your model and hence improving it. Finally, after evaluation, the project cycle is now complete, and what you get is your AI project.
Whenever we build models around AI, there are different approaches which we can follow. Number one is rule-based approach, and the second approach is learning-based approach. Now, rule-based approach, when we talk about rule-based approach, it simply says that I would give the algorithm to the machine, I would give data to the machine, and the machine needs to give me the answers. That is rule-based approach. Now, when we talk about the learning-based approach, we get into machine learning and deep learning. So you can see, a machine learning approach means we use machine to figure out relationships for us. That means I would give the machine data, I would give the machine answers, and the machine would give me rules. I would tell that, okay, I'm giving you this data, and in the end, I want this output from you. So the machine has to figure out how can it build a relation between the data and the answers. And finally, what I get as output is rules.
One of the most common and basic models in data science is the decision tree. The basic structure of a decision tree starts from the root, which is the point where the decision tree starts. From there, the tree diverges into multiple directions with the help of arrows called branches. These branches depict the condition because of which the tree diverges. In the end, the final decision is where the tree ends. These decisions are termed as the leaves of the tree. You would realize that this looks like an upside-down tree.
Let us see what decision trees are. Now this is one example of a decision tree. It's basically a model in which we ultimately come to a conclusion on the basis of various conditions. So we start off with one statement. Over here it is, am I hungry? Now am I hungry is the beginning statement, so that is why it is considered as the root. Am I hungry? Yes? No? Now these could be the two possibilities for this question. Now these two possibilities diverge the whole tree into two different directions. So that is why these two are known as branches, because it is branching the root. Now if I am not hungry, I would simply go to sleep. And if I am hungry, now I have to check. Do I have $25 or do I have 300 rupees? If yes, then I would go to a restaurant, or else I would buy a hamburger or just a burger. So what happened over here? All the yes, no, all the branching. Now the branching need not be yes, no always. As you have seen in the story speaker, it could be left, right. It could be anything according to the data which you have. Over here, our data is about yes, no. So that is why the branches are yes, no for am I hungry, and yes, no for have I $25. Now finally, go to restaurant, buy a hamburger and go to sleep are the conclusions for my decision tree. They end the decision tree. So that is why they are known as leaves. So if you visualize, this is an inverted tree which starts from the root at top and ends at the leaves on the bottom. So most of the times what happens is, there is a data set on the basis of which the decision trees are made.
For the next activity, we will look at how computers process, classify and see images. This is an example of a machine learning approach that is typically used in computer vision application. Pixel IT activity is an example of how computers see images, process them and classify them. This kind of machine learning approach is commonly used in computer vision related applications. Every image which is fed to the computer is divided into pixels, which are the smallest unit of an image. The computer analyzes each pixel, and if it has to compare two pictures to check if they are similar or not, pixel-wise comparison takes place. If pixels are identical, this means that the images are the same.
So now we'll be doing an activity in which we would ourselves will be making an AI model. So you are definitely going to make a model without any coding, but in a very fun way. Each of the team has at least 4 persons, right? So now you need to draw one alphabet on the sheet which has been given to you. Now this is a 7x7 matrix in which you need to draw an alphabet. Each table would have one single common alphabet for them. For example, you choose A, so all of you make A. You choose Z, all of you make Z. So that is how you decide one alphabet and everybody draws the same alphabet. So you need to do this, and only after that I'll explain you what the activity is.
Thank you.
something. You have actually created a model which can identify whether it is the same alphabet or not, which means each table has its own model of identifying the alphabet. So how is machine learning different from a rule-based approach? Pixelit was quite different from decision tree, because in decision tree it was a rule-based approach. You are giving rules, you are giving data, and you are getting answers. So finally, after giving data and answers, you got the rules. There are different machine learning models which are available. Some of them are supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So, three families of models: supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement. When we talk about supervised learning, it means that we are determining relationships through training. That we have some sort of data which is known to us, and we are trying to figure out a relationship out of it. When we talk about unsupervised learning, then we let the machine discover new things. We let the machine work on the data by itself. And when we talk about reinforcement learning, it's learning by rewarding actions. Supervised learning. Now, the ultimate statement which would define supervised learning is that the data which we feed to the machine is labeled. Labeled as in, we already know the data. I would explain this with an example. For example, you have 100 images of apples and 100 images of bananas. Now, when you feed these 200 images to the machine, you are telling the machine that, okay, each of the apple image is named as apple and each of the banana image is named as banana. So the machine can easily relate. Wherever it would find an apple image, it would show its name as apple, and whenever it encounters a banana image, it would show the name as banana. Now, as soon as you train the machine with these 200 images, if you enter any testing data, any random image of either an apple or a banana, the machine should be able to correctly classify it as either an apple or a banana, and it should give me the label, or it should give me the name of that image, whether it is an apple or a banana. That is supervised learning. In this, the machine already knows which data is of what label. Now, supervised learning can be of two types: classification and regression. Now, classification and regression are there in your book, while supervised learning is not. Now, what is classification? The example which I gave you right now is classification. You are classifying images whether it is an apple or a banana. Similarly, if I want to classify that out of the images of vehicles which I have, which vehicle is it? Is it a car, airplane, bicycle, truck, tractor, whatever? The machine should be able to classify it on the basis of the labels given. Okay, that is supervised learning. And then when we talk about regression, regression is when you have a data which is continuous. For example, I want to predict what my future salary is going to be. Predict that I train my model with my past salary, with the increments which I have got, which is with the incentives, with the any sort of promotions or something, and then in the end the machine should be able to predict my future salary. So this data is continuous, while in classification the data is not continuous but discrete. It's either this or that. Okay, this is supervised learning. Through the diagram as well, you can understand, whenever you are supervising the algorithm, like you are sitting over here, you are supervising the algorithm. How are you supervising it? By labeling the data. And that is when we come to the output. Now, this is a tool, I would say, or this is an experiment which you can go and check out.
Now this requires a good internet connection. I would recommend all of you to go to Google and search for teachable machine. Okay, let's move ahead. For unsupervised learning. Now unsupervised learning is a bit different from supervised learning. What is the difference? It's the data. The data which we have in unsupervised learning is unlabeled. It does not have labels. It is some sort of random data. Again, let's take it as an example. Suppose in my locality, there are 1,000 stray dogs. But I don't know what breed are they or is there a pattern out of them or not. So what did I do? I clicked pictures of all those 1,000 dogs and I fed those images into a model. Now that model will now tell me, it would itself come up with some sort of patterns, some sort of trends which the data follows, and it would divide the data into chunks of similar type. And finally, what would I get? I would get a data which has been separated into clusters according to similar features. Which features? That the machine itself has figured out. So most of the times it might happen that the machine would come up with a very new pattern which you might not have even imagined. Maybe they have clustered the dogs with same color together, with same size together, maybe with same angle of standing together, any pattern. So because over here the data was unlabeled, the data was unknown to me, it did not have any sort of name, it was random. I fed the machine with some random data and the machine was able to classify or cluster them together. Finally, what you get as clustering data can be easily taken as labeled data. Third part, reinforcement learning. Now when we talk about reinforcement learning, we are talking about training the model using rewarding actions. Now what does rewarding actions mean? For example, I need to go from the stage to the last table over there. Okay. How would I do? I'm a robot and I need to go from the stage to the table and I need to find the shortest way possible or the most rewarding way. How does it happen? I step down, then I move straight. But then this table obstructs me. So as soon as I encounter an obstacle, I get a negative. -5, suppose. Then, yes, I would change my path. Then I would either go to the left or the right. Similarly, I would try as many ways as possible. And in the end, I would come up with the best possible way, which is the most rewarding. This is how reinforcement learning works. Is it clear? No obstructions. As less obstructions as possible. Okay. So this is some DeepMind AI developed by Google. As you can see, it is again based on reinforcement learning. The AI model has not been taught how to walk. It has come up with its own algorithms to walk and to reach from point A to point B. And it was just taught the virtual sensors are given to the AI. It can look at its orientation, it can understand where it is, how it is, what is the orientation, and accordingly it makes its own moves. And this is how reinforcement learning works.
Let's understand and experience what a neural network is like. Neural networks are loosely modeled after how neurons in the human brain behave. The key advantage of neural networks are that they are able to extract data features automatically without needing the input of the programmer. A neural network is essentially a system of organizing machine learning algorithms to perform certain tasks. It is a fast and efficient way to solve problems for which the data set is very large, such as in images. Let us develop a better understanding about this concept with the help of a game called Human Neural Network. Ground rules. No one is allowed to talk or discuss till the game ends. Fun of the game lies in playing it honestly. Each layer should sit distant to each other. The image shown only be shown to the input layer and no one else. The game is supposed to be played silently. This means that one has to write a word on the chit and pass on the chit without speaking out aloud. One needs to process the data as fast as possible. Hence, not much time can be taken to write and pass on the chits. Input layer nodes cannot discuss the image shown with each other. Everyone has to use their own discretion. No sentences or multiple words are to be written on the chit. Only one word per chit is allowed. Once the task of a layer is finished, that layer needs to go and sit aside and not disturb others till the game ends.
Neural networks is a very complex kind of a thing if we introduce it to the kids. So that's why we have tried putting it as a game. 20 people out of you all would come on the stage and they would be divided into input layer, hidden layer 1, hidden layer 2 and the output layer. Now the task of input layer is to get the data and pass it on to the hidden layers. So we would be giving some sort of data to the input layer and they have to understand it and have to make some sense out of it and send it to hidden layer 1. Now hidden layer 1 needs to process this data and send some meaningful information which they can call out of the data to hidden layer 2. Then hidden, according to their own thinking. Now, each of the person who would be standing over here in the game would be acting as an individual node. You are not a team, okay? Nodes cannot talk. They have their own processing abilities. So as soon as the hidden layer 1 processes the data, it sends the processed data to the hidden layer 2. Hidden layer 2 then again further processes it. And finally, the ultimate processing data is sent to the output, and output would then again make some sense out of it and give it back to us. Then we look at it as to how effective and how efficient the processing is of the whole neural network. Okay, it won't process, it would just summarize, you would say. It would just sum up the whole data which it is getting from the hidden layer 2 to make it presentable. This side. So up now you can see we have a neural network which has 7 input nodes, 6 nodes in hidden layer 1. Ma'am, please join the hidden layer 1 layer back. Yeah. Hidden layer 2 and then output node. Now what are you supposed to do? I would show an image, one single image, to all these 7 nodes of the input layer.
You need to look at the image, make some sense out of it, and you need to write 6 different words, one word each on one sticky note. Okay, so you will have 6 chits and on each chit there will be one word which is in some way describing the image. Now your goal is that maximum data should reach the output node. So you need to think accordingly, but you cannot write 2 words or a sentence or a phrase on the
one word.
Just one word on the sticky note. So please take 6 notes and pass it on. You would get 7 words. Out of the 7 words which you get, you need to select any 4. Okay?
That's 7.
Now you have not seen the image. You need to process the data which you have got from the input here. Process it in such a way that the most meaningful words go ahead to hidden layer 2, which makes most sense to you. At most, you need to pass 2 chits, one word each chit. Okay? And then finally, how many nodes would output layer get?
12.
You would definitely get 12. Now finally, your job is to summarize all the 12 chits and write a 2-3 line of a description that what possibly could the image be at the input.
Thank you.
card, camera, lens, photography, voice, camera once again, show, mic, forest and lab. Trying to correlate all of them, there are a group of friends who are together in a forest, kind of a show, wherein one of them is on a mic and somebody else is clicking a photograph.
Co-curricular activities. Following activities from the content can be assessed under co-curricular activities. Excite module. Kahoot quiz. Conduct an online Kahoot quiz. Alternative, pen or paper quiz. Relate module. Story speaker activity. To write an interactive story using the Google Doc extension of Story Speaker. Possibilities module. Job advertisement poster making. Create a poster for a job advertisement describing the job created and skills required for the same after 10 years. AI ethics module. Balloon debate. Conducting a balloon debate wherein the teams talk in favor of AI and against AI, relating it to various domains like agriculture, transport, security, etc. Problem scoping. Article writing. Write an article about the problem which you have scoped and how you wish to solve it using artificial intelligence.